Good morning, friends and family. Good morning, church. My name is Sam Anderson. For those that do not know me, muy buenos días a todos. Me llamo Samuel. Para los que no me conocen, here at Valley Christian, along with my wife and our amazing team, we lead the youth and family ministry. And it's actually that ministry that has inspired this morning's message. The theme of this morning's message has to do with being together. It's the spirit of togetherness, and hopefully you'll see images of being a close spiritual family. I really do believe that the scriptures that I will share this morning really can impact our view of just being a close, connected, spiritual family, adults and children included. Before we get into the word, let's go to God in a word of prayer. Dear Father God, thank you so much just for this new spiritual family that you've created through the cross. You know, it's only through Jesus' sacrifice that we have this new family where we may not be connected or related by blood, but through the cross, we're related and connected through his blood, through Jesus' blood. Please help us to get a glimpse of the vision you have for your spiritual family. And I just pray that you can really move our hearts and just give us such a clear imagery of what our church family could be like here at Valley Christian and just across the world. Thank you so much for your love. In your son's name we pray. Amen. Let's start our time in Deuteronomy chapter 31, verses 11 to 13. It says, when all Israel comes to appear before the Lord your God, at the place he will choose, you shall read this law before them in their hearing. Assemble the people, men, women, and children, and the foreigners residing in your towns, so they can listen and learn to fear the Lord your God and follow carefully all the words of this law. Their children, who do not know this law, must hear it and learn to fear the Lord your God as long as you live and the land you're crossing the Jordan to possess. You know, in the book of Deuteronomy, throughout the entire book, God, through Moses, is reminding the people of the laws he expects them to obey in the land that they're getting ready to possess. So he gives laws regarding to justice, regarding to love, regarding to their worship. And towards the end of the book, through Moses, He gives this command to the priests and to the elders, two forms of leadership of Israel. He calls them to make a copy of the law, and he gives them this command. Every 7 years, during this time of year, you are to publicly read from the book of the law. And who's supposed to be in attendance? Well, first of all, assemble everyone, men, women, foreigner, and children. And then he goes on to say, or Moses, so they can listen and learn to fear the Lord. And I really do think it's worth mentioning, you know, God has the same desire, regardless of your age, regardless if you're older or younger, he wants you to learn to fear him, to worship him, to learn to have a relationship with him. And I look at this event, you know, and just God really making this command of having this national focus of publicly reading of the law and to expound on it. And I'm convicted by the attendance, honestly, because I feel like in our day and age, in our culture, we can look at this and think, wow, this doesn't seem to be too effective. You have adults and children at the same place trying to learn from the word. It's like, no, separate them. Give the kids their kid lesson. Give the adults the adult lesson. You don't want them distracting one another. You know, if they're families with small kids, have one adult come one night or one day and have one adult stay at home and watch the kids. The next day they can switch spots and maybe they teach them at home, but don't bring them with the other adult. We can think like that in our culture today. And I look at this passage, I look at this event, and those thoughts don't seem to be of concern. It's like, well, first of all, I don't know how effective this time was, but what I do know is that God expected them to be there all together, both adults and children. There is no, hey, children, go learn over there. Adults, go learn over there. It's like, no, they're going to be there together, both hearing from the Word of God and learning together. And I think with this in mind, but also looking at a passage in Joshua chapter 8, verse 34 to 35, I think it's also just as convicting, you know, with those thoughts in mind. It says, afterward, Joshua read all the words of the law, all the words of the law, the blessings and the curses, just as it is written in the book of the law. There was not a word of all that Moses had commanded that Joshua did not read to the whole assembly of Israel, including the women and children and the foreigners who lived among them. This is another convicting passage. Why is it convicting? Because in the book of Joshua, Joshua is now leading the people, and through God's guidance and God actually leading Joshua as he's leading the people, there's a number of victories that they have, you know, early on in the book of Joshua. At their number of victories, you see Joshua putting into practice one of the commands of Moses, which was to publicly read from the book of the law. And it just stands out that it says that he read all the words of the law. Blessings and curses. I don't know if you ever read Deuteronomy chapter 27, 28, and you see some of the blessings and the curses that comes from obedience and disobedience. Like, God uses some strong language in those chapters. And it says that he read it all. Every command, every word that Moses has ever commanded, Joshua read. And who was in attendance? Both adults and the children. You know, I think in our culture today, it's like, well, what if they don't understand? Or what if they get bored? You know, they should just hear a little bit. And then after, we should do a bunch of games. And or maybe they should hang out and the adults get the full, you know, weight of the word. It's like, that doesn't seem to be the case here as Joshua is publicly reading from the word. It's like, no, we're going to be there together and we're all going to listen to the word of God. There's the spirit of togetherness. And really, it's that spirit that I really have envisioned for our fellowship here at Valley Christian. Now, just this heart of both adults and children learning what it means to fear God. Now, as I say, this spirit of togetherness, I'm not speaking of the togetherness that you would think of when you think of a crowd attending a sporting event. Because to a degree, I mean, imagine any sporting event that you ever attended. Whether it was a professional basketball game, whether it was a baseball game, if you were to look at the crowd, to one degree or another, one can reason that they are together to some extent, yeah, because they're gathered at the same spot. They might not all be connected relationally, but as you look at a crowd at a sporting event, one can say, well, they're together. And the togetherness that I'm referring to is it's much deeper than that. It goes beyond that. I'm speaking of the togetherness that you would use to describe a family, where there are intimate bonds between the youth in the family, but also the adults in the family. So when I say this is a spirit of being together, I'm referring to being together as a family. And with that in mind, I want to read a passage in Galatians chapter 6, verse 10. It says, therefore, whenever we have the opportunity, we should do good to everyone, especially to those in the family of faith. Now, why do I read this scripture? Because there's a number of images that the New Testament uses to describe the church, the believers saved, you know, through the blood of Jesus. There are images of the church being that of a bride, this beautiful bride of Christ. The church is related to being a temple, a spiritual temple, and how we each kind of represent a stone in that spiritual temple. There's imagery of the church being like a body, and there's an arm, there's a leg, there's a head, and that's Christ. But another image that is used to describe the church is that of a family, of being a spiritual household. And that's why you get the language of brothers and sisters a lot in the New Testament letters. Love your brothers and sisters. Love your brothers and sisters. Because the writers are presenting this image of a family where there are new relationships. In the church is supposed to be the spiritual family where there's these close sibling relationships, brothers and sisters. Now, keep that in mind as we read this next passage. And I really want to read this next passage because I do think the two ideas really fit well together. What do I mean by that? 1 Timothy 1, verses 1 to 2. This is Paul writing to Timothy. He says, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the command of God, our Savior, and of Christ Jesus, our hope, to Timothy, my true son in the faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus, our Lord. Now, Paul writing Timothy. Paul refers to Timothy as his true son in the faith. Now, Paul wasn't literally Timothy's father. Timothy's father was a Greek. However, Paul was involved in the conversion of Timothy. And to describe the depth of their relationship, he gives this imagery of Timothy being a son in the faith and him being, and Paul being like this spiritual father. It wasn't the literal relationship, but it was a metaphor to describe the depth of the relationship. Paul was like a father to Timothy. And I bring up that passage because what if we actually took that metaphor a bit deeper and we extended that metaphor to not only see ourselves as spiritual parents to others, but what if we took on the imagery of being spiritual uncles and aunts to the youth in our church fellowship? What do I mean by that? Earlier, I mentioned that the church is related to being a family of faith, the spiritual household. If we're truly brothers and sisters in the faith, and if I have kids and if you have kids, that creates an automatic bond if we're siblings. We now become uncles and aunts to each other's children. Let me give you an example of that. When myself, I have two siblings. I have two older sisters. We're all 4 years apart. And we've definitely gotten closer throughout the years where we've all gotten married and we all have kids, you know, of our own. And we are brothers and sisters. I am their brother. They are my sisters. And as soon as my sisters had kids, in that moment, I became an uncle. I didn't have to apply. I didn't sign anything. I didn't ask for it. The fact that we are siblings, as soon as my sisters had kids, I became an uncle. And vice versa. You know, since I am their brother alone, as soon as I had kids, they became aunts to my kids. You see, our sibling relationship automatically created a bond between us and each other's children. And my thought is, what if we embrace that imagery in the church? That with our brothers and sisters in the faith, if we're truly siblings in the faith, as soon as one of us has kids, that automatically makes the others that of a spiritual aunt and uncle. If we embrace that imagery, how do you think it would influence how we gather as a church? So, question, what if we embrace this mindset of being spiritual aunts and uncles? Again, it's a metaphor. Similar to how Paul referred to Timothy as his true son in the faith, I'm saying if we really embrace this metaphor of being spiritual aunts and uncles, how would it influence our church family? You know, I would think that to a degree, it would make our gatherings feel more of like a family dinner. You know, if you look at this image, you know, I'm referring to that family dinner where there are mixed relationships, you know, the parents, the children, the uncles, the aunts, and the nephews and the nieces. But if you look at the picture on the left, it's more than that relationship that you could kind of see in the picture on the left. On the picture on the left, yeah, the children are with the adults, but they're kind of off to the side. You know, they're at the kids' table. And I would imagine that if we were to embrace this mindset of being spiritual aunts and uncles in our church, it would be less likely that the youth would feel like they're constantly being put at the kids' table. Hey, go hang out with your friends. You know, the adults are going to gather here and get spiritual with each other and get close. But you go to the kids' table. No, I would imagine it would be more like the picture on the right, where you have adults and youth at the same table connecting. And I just imagine my family and just the the men and women in the church here at Valley Christian. I might be at the table and I'm just talking with AJ. I'm talking with AJ Melson. Hey, what's up, man? What's going on? While I have Luna, my daughter, my oldest daughter, on my lap, she's trying to get my attention. I say, hey, one second. I'm talking with AJ. But as I do that, I'm sitting next to Bri Zambrano. And she leans over and she actually starts messing around with Luna. And she's talking with Luna and conversating with her. And as far as I know, I all of a sudden hear a little giggling on my right. And I look over and I see Jaden Trapp. So I start turning to Jaden and I start talking. And it's just a mix of relationships, of conversation. I think if we truly embrace this metaphor of spiritual aunts and uncles, we're brothers and sisters in the faith, that makes me connected with your children, it would feel more of like a family dinner. I think another image that comes to mind is that of a family reunion. You know, if you look at the two pictures, I'm not talking about the family reunion that you see on the left, where you see just a group of adults huddling together, just in a some sense, forming a clique. You know, me and my wife used to lead this youth and family ministry in another church. And sometimes we would help the kids not to form cliques, because sometimes they could associate with those that they relate to more in personality, or those that are their age, or just those that they like better. And they would form these little pockets of relationships. And we always try to encourage, you know, be outward focused. You know, sometimes adults can form cliques with other adults when it comes to youth being present. You know, could you imagine a family reunion when the aunts and the uncles only spoke to their nieces and nephews just to greet them and just to say goodbye? Other than that, they're hanging out with their siblings. Could you imagine a family reunion like that, or a family dynamic? And that is not the vision that I'm portraying with our church family when it comes to being together as a family. I'm talking about the picture on the right. And if you look at that picture on the right, if you look closely, you will see adults connecting with adults, and you will see youth connecting with youth. But if you look closely, you will also see adults connecting with youth and that intergenerational relationship. And it's really those intergenerational relationships that I imagine being throughout our church family. Adults connecting with the youth. And I think there's a handful, dozens of great examples of that here at Valley Christian. I would love if we could pursue that all together. Again, how would it influence our gatherings if we took on this metaphor of being spiritual aunts and uncles? If we're a part of the family of faith, if we're siblings in the faith, we're brothers and sisters in Christ, that automatically creates a bond with each other's children, being spiritual aunts and uncles. You know, as we come to a landing in this sermon, I want to close out with a couple of practicals in mind. But before I get to those practicals, I do want to just validate maybe some thoughts that you might have of your own in terms of, like, maybe I've tried, but it didn't work out. You know, I do know as an uncle, this is a two-way street. You know, as I'm speaking to the adults that are tuning in, this is a two-way street. And I know that because I am an uncle. There's been times, you know, I've tried to connect with some of my nieces and nephews, and I can remember stories or memories of even connecting with a particular niece of mine. When she's not in the mood, she's not in the mood. You know, I could go for a hug. She gives me a little shoulder. I could ask her how she's doing. She'll say like a one-word answer and not even look at me. This was obviously when she was much younger. But I know, like, I've tried, and if there's no buy-in from the youth, you know, it probably won't go too far. And that's understandable. It's a two-way street. And if there are youth that are listening to this video, to this service, you know, I actually want to encourage you. You know, could you imagine if the main influencers in your life were all your age, were all your peers? How do you imagine that would go? Like, the person who taught you how to drive, the person who is teaching you in school, the person that teaches you about finances, the person who teaches you just, what would you imagine your life would become if all your main influencers were your age? You know, I think you would agree. It probably wouldn't turn out well. And with that, I do want you to feel encouraged. And I just want to motivate you to be open to having a friendships with other spiritual, mature adults in the community of faith. Obviously, under the guidance and the boundaries of your parents, I'm referring to those of toddlers, little kids, all the way up to high school, but obviously under the guidance of your parents. But I want to encourage you to be open to those relationships. Now, when it comes to the adults, I want to share a personal story of mine. Oh, but before that, I want to ask you, are you familiar with the idiom on paper? This is what the case is on paper. But in reality, this isn't the case. It's an idiom used to kind of describe like, this is like what it is in theory. Like, this is what it's supposed to be. But in reality, it's not really what's happening. On paper, we're close friends. But in reality, we don't really talk that much. So on paper is an idiom that I think a lot of us are familiar with. I had an uncle that I would say on paper, he was my uncle. And why do I say that? He was my uncle on paper because he was the brother. He passed, years back. He was the brother of my mom, but I never met him. We never talked. I only know a little bit about him from what my family shared, but we had no relationship. I've never met him one time. Never had a conversation on the phone. On paper, he was my uncle. But in reality, he wasn't really my uncle, if you know what I mean. And I don't want that for our church family here at Valley Christian, because I do feel like a lot of us, maybe we could feel at times that, okay, siblings, brothers and sisters in the faith, I should be connected with your kids. On paper, we're spiritual aunts and uncles, but in reality, are we really behaving like those spiritual aunts and uncles in the lives of our youth here at Valley Christian? So let's not be spiritual aunts and uncles on paper. Let's really be about that calling. And I want to close out with just asking three questions to help help clarify some steps you can take in moving forward. And one question is, and speaking of they, referring to the youth in the church, the different spiritual, quote unquote, nephews and nieces. Do they know your name? Could you imagine being an uncle and an aunt and having several nieces and nephews and none of them really knew your name? That kind of speaks to the relationship that you have with them. So I start with that question. When it comes to, the other brothers and sisters that you're connected with in the church and they have kids, do they even know your name? Or do you need to start being more consistent in greeting them and introducing yourself and saying hi so they can remember your name? Second question, do they enjoy being around you? So that's a step further. That's a step deeper into the friendship. Do they enjoy being around you? It's one thing if they know your name. It's another thing is that do they enjoy when you're around? Do they look forward to talking to you? Do they look forward to, just to seeing you on a Sunday or seeing you at family group? You probably got to try a little bit harder to get to that point in the relationship to when they actually enjoy, being near you. And another question, do they trust you? And I think this is probably the most depth of the relationship of the three questions, because it's one thing if they know your name, and hopefully they know your name in a good sense. Hopefully it's not like that weird uncle or not, but they know your name in a good sense. They enjoy being around you, but it's another thing if they actually trust you. That when times get hard with mom and dad at home, they don't feel like they have anyone to talk to, could they see you as someone that they would trust with the details of their life? Or trust to share some doubts that they may have about God? That requires even more effort. And I share those questions just to help you get a gauge in where you may be in your relationship with the youth in the church. Where are you at? You might be in similar spots with some kids and other spots with other kids. I know for me, I would probably say I'm at spot number two and number three. I'm at a spot where I'm still trying to, have the youth feel comfortable around me and, enjoy being around me. But there's others that do feel comfortable and they do enjoy being around me. But it's another question of whether or not they trust me. And I'm really trying to build that trust in that relationship. But where are you at? And just as an encouragement, if you're not sure where to start, two great areas or two great aspects of our church that I would encourage you to start is, or at least look into, is Kids Club, our children's ministry, because this is the exact type of environment that we're trying to create in our Sunday's children's ministry, but also family group. You know, we have family group throughout the church. And if you have other members in your family group that have kids all the way up into high school, I would find that as a starting place. You know, start building those relationships with those kids in your family group. But church, friends, thank you so much for tuning in this morning. Hopefully you really got the sense of, you know, God's heart for us being a family that is together, not just adults and adults and youth, but adults and youth, really embracing the imagery of being spiritual aunts and uncles. Thank you so much for tuning in this morning. I hope you have a great rest of your Sunday.
Everything I once held dear, I count it all. like a hurricane, and I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us all. He is jealous for me. Loves like a hurricane, and tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us all. Yeah, he loves us. Oh,
how he loves us. Oh, how Thank you again for joining us online. We are so glad that you did. We'd like to invite you to continue your experience by joining a discussion and fellowship. All you have to do if you would like to join is click on the link in the description below the video. We hope that you really enjoy that. If you are not watching it live, we would like to invite you to get more information, to ask a question, or to maybe even join a Bible study by clicking on the link in the description below the video. Feel free to explore and get more information. But whatever you do, have a great week. God bless. Thank you for coming. Thank you.